evening, neighbors. Welcome to Williams Around the Way. My name is Tonya Richardson. I'm the Public Relations and Communications Officer for Mayor Dennis P. Williams and the City of Wilmington. We really appreciate you joining us here this weekend. Our mission here every second and fourth Sunday is to provide an opportunity to talk about initiatives that are important not only to the mayor, but to communities around the city. And we have so much to share with you this weekend. I'll be talking to Jeff Flynn and Alfred Lance, who are respectively the director and deputy director of the Mayor's Office of Economic Development. And they will be joined by Brian Lennon, who is the Assistant Water Division Director with the City Department of Public Works. Those gentlemen will join me to help share with you important progress on what's been called the South Wilmington Wetlands Project. It's a project that affects the Southbridge area of the city and impacts not only quality of life overall with the well-known flooding that happens in that area, but also eventually the economic development and environmental issues from that part of the city. I'll also speak with Lenny Safran. Lenny is the director of the city's Department of Planning and Development, and he will share information about an upcoming community event wherein the long desired plans for the City of Wilmington Skate and Wellness Plaza will be revealed for the community in just a few weeks, along with introductions by partners from that project. It'll be a great opportunity not only to learn about how this long planned initiative is about to move forward, but to also hear about what to expect from the event, which is being called a skate jam. But before I start, as always, I have a few announcements, and I want to recap some things that have been going on since the last Williams Around the Way. To begin, I want to just remind everyone that the Don't Count Me Out Women's Conference will be happening on Saturday, November 7th, 2015. At 10 a.m. at Easian Fair Baptist Church in the hall that is located at 1400 B Street here in the City of Wilmington. The event will feature speakers Edwina Bell, Ebon Flagg, and Allison Moore, and tickets are available at www.waynasworld.com, and that's spelled www.waynasworld.com. Tickets are $40 and are on sale through October 23rd. It'll be a great opportunity to be empowered by women and men in the community who are inspiring us to overcome and to move forward. On the evening of Wednesday, October 7th, Mayor Williams and City Council holded the 13th Annual Wilmington Awards. The awards are designed to recognize and honor Wilmingtonians who are doing outstanding things in the community. Wilmington Award recipients exemplify excellence in the areas of art, health and science, heroism, professionalism, volunteerism, and human civil rights. This year's cohorts of awardees span the gamut of nonprofits such as St. Patrick's Service Center, businesses such as Maisley's Gloves, and even volunteerism, where recipient Jacqueline Means, a 12-year-old, was honored for work that she's doing in Southbridge. I say this all the time, and you'll hear me say this going forward. Honors and events such as the Wilmington Awards are great opportunities for us to be reminded that good things are happening in our city, and that we should all be inspired to do our part, large or small, to continue to make the city a great place to live, work, and play. Yesterday, the city, along with 15 partners from across the state, held the My Brother's Keeper 2015 Action Summit. The event was held at the Orlando George Wilmington campus of Dell Tech, just on Orange Street in downtown Wilmington, and was attended by people who were interested in seeing presentations, feedback sessions, and opportunities to engage and talk about the network of innovative partnerships that will make My Brother's Keeper a success here in the city. Many of you will recognize My Brother's Keeper as President Obama's challenge made last year to elected officials and Native American tribal leaders all over the country, asking us to get together as a community on our terms and determine the partnerships and initiatives that we believe will affect young people in our state and carry them from birth through graduation, through careers into a lifetime. President Obama really believes that all children should have resources and adults who support them and make it possible for them to achieve their life goals, regardless of their station in life, regardless of what family they've been born into, regardless of what school they go to, regardless of what neighborhood that they live in. We're really proud to be a pillar partner in this endeavor at the City of Wilmington. And in upcoming broadcasts, I'll have Dr. Jacqueline Jenkins as my guest. She is the mayor's chief strategist for education, and we'll talk about progress with My Brother's Keeper as well as other education initiatives going on in the city. On Thursday, October 1st, Old Brandywine Village celebrated its 50th anniversary. The neighborhood known as Old Brandywine Village has, since the City of Wilmington's early development, been a positioned community that's at the center of pretty much everything. Because of its location, prominent families such as the Lees, the Shipleys, the Tatnalls, the Canbys have all been involved in important things that go on in the city and don't just affect downtown. The celebration of the 50th anniversary was held at the Old Pumping Station, which is a part of the Water Department now for the City of Wilmington, and you'll see we have some photographs here. And the event was held such that people who are involved with the Civic Association and friends of the Civic Association could really celebrate what this particular civic is doing. What makes them different from other civic associations is they are nonprofit. They were incorporated some time ago. And they work very closely with the city to help make Old Brandywine Village a pillar in the downtown footprint so that you really have the sense that at one end you have the riverfront and at the other end of downtown you have Old Brandywine Village. And you'll see there is particular celebration about the lighting of the stack house, which is above the pumping station. So now the entire station is lit. It's beautiful against the Brandywine River, and we congratulate their Civic Association for 50 years of amazing work in the city. Lastly, I'd like to announce that the City, Faithful Friends, Animal Society, the Delaware Humane Association, and Boys and Girls Clubs of Delaware are excited to announce a free vaccine clinic for our community's cats and dogs. The free clinic will be held on Sunday, October 25th from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. at Frame Boys and Girls Club, which is located at 669 South Union Street. That's right on the border of Wilmington and Ellesmere. The first 700 animals in attendance will receive free rabies and distemper vaccinations for dogs and free FVRCP vaccinations for cats. Just bring your crated or leashed animal to the Frame Boys Club on Sunday the 25th to benefit from this really great opportunity offered by the city and partners whose mission is to care for the quality of life of animals and their owners. And a big thanks to the Boys and Girls Club for hosting this event. Please stay with us over this short break. Next, I'll be back with leadership from Economic Development and Public Works to talk about the South Wilmington Wetlands Project. Please stay with us.
Can
the Way. Again, I'm Tonya Richardson. I'm with Communications of the Mayor's Office. And we're really glad to take this opportunity to spend some time to talk about projects that are going on down in South Wilmington. The Wilmington Riverfront offers a wide range of attractions for visitors. It includes, as many of you know, dining options, family attractions, the wildlife refuge, walking trails, businesses focused on your fitness and wellness. There are residential options down at the riverfront. It's really become a hallmark of the city of Wilmington. But the story of the riverfront doesn't end there. South Wilmington is really a part of that picture too. That development was really the first phase of a big picture of development that's happening at the riverfront and in the wetlands that affect South Wilmington. The second phase of development of that large area of wetland is adjacent to Route 13 and Southbridge. Team partners, including city officials and community stakeholders, have reached a pivotal moment of synergy where plans to redevelop low-lying wetland areas of the city are moving forward in a really significant way. My guests on set now are Jeff Flynn and Alfred Lance, who are respectively the director and deputy director of the Mayor's Office of Economic Development. And joining us also is Brian Lennon, who is the assistant water division director for the Department of Public Works. Jeff, Alfred, and Brian, along with many other of my colleagues in public works, economic development, planning, are core to some updates that we'd like to give you about things going on in Southbridge. Gentlemen, thanks for joining us. Thanks for joining me. We've had conversations about this project several times, and I think it's a great opportunity for us here today to talk about the project, not only for our neighbors who may have no idea what's going on because it's been such a long-term planning process, but to explain it like you explain it to me in a very primer 101 way so that neighbors can really understand the magnitude not only of the planning but what's about to happen. Jeff, if you could start us off in this conversation. Most Wilmingtonians know that flooding is a huge issue in Southbridge. Every time it rains, if we have even a moderate weather event, there's water in the streets of Southbridge. Was this an event that kind of crystallized movement for the wetlands project as it is right now?
First off, Southbridge is a very low-lying area geographically. So right out of the gates, it has that constraint compared to other parts of the city. The infrastructure that was installed in Southbridge has low angles, so it gets clogged and blocked easier than infrastructure in other parts of the city. It's also old, and so in 2006, a drainage study was completed as part of the South Special Area Management Plan, which was a federal grant to Wilmington through the state of Delaware, and what resulted from the SAMP, Special Area Management Plan, was a drainage study. And that drainage study combined with a neighborhood plan was the sort of the genesis for the wetland park. That idea came forth from those two planning studies.
Great. I'm going to do a lot of recapping in our conversation. So even before the study, there was a plan in Southbridge that talked about what are we going to do about the flooding. And with the grant money that the city was able to get from the federal government, we were able to do studies to make that existing plan kind of meld with a larger plan to address not just the original ideas, but to kind of expand upon it and take it even further than that. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay.
That's right.
Thanks. Alfred, one of the major outcomes of that SAMP study was the idea to create like a central park in the wetlands. That area is situated right in the middle of South Wilmington between South Walnut Street and the Southbridge community. How does that idea of creating a central park out of that wetlands work?
Well, as you said, the Central Park concept was something that came out of the SAMP plan, and it was an idea and opportunity to create a premier park in that area of the city. It was already open space, but beyond being just an attractive park with recreational trails and things like that, it was going to be a stormwater utility. And it will serve the function of holding the stormwater that gets diverted from the pipes and such, so that it would not flood the streets and homes and the businesses of South Wilmington. So it was really a creative and ingenious idea of taking a park and using that park to address the flooding issues that happen on a regular basis in the Southbridge community.
That is huge, because I think a lot of us as just residents who are consumers of these spaces, we're thinking, oh, a nice green space, or, you know, a pretty place to walk the stroller and the dog. But this is very unique, because as we'll discuss, this is going to do a lot more than just become an amazing feature in the town, in the area there of Southbridge. And I think the SAMP also highlights that this has been going on for like a decade or more. This is not a new project where all of a sudden government locally, regionally, federally have noticed the type of flooding that we're showing now in some of the photographs. But the community itself and all of those other entities have been paying attention for quite a while, and it's taken this long to kind of get to a place where the funding is in place and all the partners are in place. And again, we'll get into that a little more. Brian, as the water engineer on the team, I've learned from you that the process of delinking the storm system in this project will have a lot to do with eventually having a dry Southbridge. Can you talk about that part of the project?
Yes. Many residents of Southbridge and South Wilmington are surprised to learn that Southbridge, like 90% of the rest of the city, has a combined sewer overflow collection system, a collection system of pipes underneath the ground that carry away a combined sanitary sewer flow, the flow that comes from your plumbing fixtures in your houses and your businesses. Mm-hmm. And it also uses those same very pipes to carry the rainwater that lands on our streets and our rooftops. And it carries that flow to the wastewater treatment plant. This type of system, while it's surprising to hear that we have one system of pipes that carries both, it's typical of the construction that happened in the city of Philadelphia, New York, Washington, D.C., Baltimore, back at the turn of the century when the system was put in. So the way the system works is on a normal dry day, all the flow from the sanitary fixtures and the businesses and residents gets carried in the pipes and goes down to the wastewater treatment plant to be treated before it's discharged out into the Delaware River. Mm-hmm. However, when it rains, the rainfall that lands on the streets and the rooftops gets into those same pipes, gets carried down towards the wastewater treatment plant, but during large rainfall events, the amount of rainfall overwhelms the capacity of the pipes in the system to carry that flow to the wastewater treatment plant, and so that excess combined flow overflows to the river. It's not the most desired way to manage a system, but that's the system that we inherited from our engineers 100 years ago. What makes the problem particularly difficult to manage in South Wilmington is South Wilmington being a low-lying area. There's many intersections in South Wilmington that are at an elevation of about 4.5 or 5 feet above sea level. And so during some rain events that happen to happen at high tide and when the river level is high, the excess flow that needs to discharge out through the outfall to the river, if the river is high due to high tide and storm surge conditions, the flow can't get out to the river and it backs up in the streets and intersections of South Wilmington and causes the flooding that we see.
I have to tell you and tell viewers how fascinated I am by all of this. Living in the city and knowing that Southbridge floods, it is comforting to hear that the professionals understand why it's happening, and that because you understand it, we can get to a place where there can be a solution. And that solution is going to be beautiful, but it's also going to be functional. and do something that affects the infrastructure in a way that doesn't just affect us in the city, but it affects people who are part of our water system outside the city. Is that correct?
Yes,
that's correct.
One of the things that we at Public Works and the people that are very interested and dedicate their careers to water quality in the city are very excited about this project because it has it's solving multiple problems at once. One aspect is that by constructing this wetlands park that will serve as a stormwater utility, it'll help reduce the frequency and the amount of overflows that go to the river, thereby cleaning up the river in that way. And by creating a wetland park that's at a lower elevation than those intersections at Southbridge that flood, it gives us a place to let that water flow down to a lower elevation, and then during periods when the river level is high, it can store it in the wetland and wait until the tide comes back down and release it. And that's the real key aspect of why this wetland park is needed to solve the flooding in South Wilmington, is because during times when we want to discharge that water out to the river, that storm water, even if we separated the system, we need a place to temporarily store it until the river level comes back down.
That's amazing. That's amazing.
And one thing that we're really excited about too is that by passing that storm water that we separate out in the streets through the wetland facility, we'll actually treat the storm water and through natural ecological processes and discharge a cleaner storm water out to the river than even many areas outside the city that have separated systems.
Right, and as a side note, our water treatment process already exceeds the requirements across the board. So even the water that does go to the treatment plant, it bears just mentioning as a side note that the city of Wilmington does more to treat that water before it releases it back out than we even have to anyway. So it's nice to hear that this renovation is going to kind of continue Wilmington's commitment to being good stewards of the environment as we do that. Well, as the wetlands are right now, this very minute, Jeff, is this like something that can just happen and let's get going and let's start renovating? Or are there things that have to be done to the wetlands first before we get started? Is there contamination? What's kind of there?
What's there right now is a large open area with, they're called phragmites. They sort of look like cattails and other growth that has, it's been born or grown out of an area that was filled, like a marshy area that over the past 100 years was filled by Wilmington's industrial processes. And now if you walk back there's some soft spots or some high ground, but it's very dense. And there, eventually, when we get to construction, the first thing we'll do is clear that area and then start to excavate out those portions and lower the areas of the wetland that are going to hold and carry the water. Okay. There was really interestingly an environmental constraint on the site. The site had welcomed, the owner of the site had welcomed fill from an Amtrak location, and this was back in the time where it was okay to fill lands, and Amtrak was invited on by the owner. Well, it turns out as laws change and regulations develop, what was dumped there became against regulation or out of compliance. So Amtrak and the landowner worked with Denrec to basically build a container for a portion of the site. And what we're going to do now is that's going to become a meadow. And it's all the engineering and the science behind it sort of captures the contaminant in there, and that's where it stays forever while we develop the wetland around it.
Again, fascinating. As a citizen, you hear, oh, X, Y, or Z project is about to happen, and then you wonder, what are they doing over there? When am I going to see my wetland park? When are they going to put up the boardwalks? But there are things that have to be done first. And
that's
so
right.
What you're saying is, before we can begin to address the flooding via the stormwater system renovation, some prep has to be done to that area to not only clean it up so that once everything is ready to go, the environment will be stable to be healthy, but also to make it low enough to actually do what it is we need for it to do.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. What I just described, that took place in the past 2 years. And so moving forward, the next milestone is an approval by the Army Corps of Engineers. We are working on that application as a project team, and we hope to submit that in late November. And then the Army Corps review could be 6 to 12 months. While that review is taking place, our project team will continue to push the design details forward. We're always working with the community of Southbridge, with their real key stakeholder group that has informed this project going as far back as 2004. And then various departments within the city, as you know, have contributed to this project on a weekly basis. So we'll move the design forward while the feds are reviewing the document. When we get approval from then, we'll move on to doing what's called construction documents. And those are the detailed level drawings that then will allow us to go out and bid the work. And then, of course, after that happens, we get permits from the city, and then we can start.
All good to know. This is all good to know. And it's good we have this opportunity to share this level of detail. In particular, I think what, you know, our neighbors would want to know is, what are the financial resources that are on the table making this happen? And I happen to know that there are some key things that have happened in terms of funding that have made it possible for us to start talking at this level. Can you share some of the money story of this project with us?
You're best to answer that one, Jeff.
Well, nothing happens without money. And this project is a blend of city capital dollars, okay? And, you know, Mayor Williams is a huge proponent of this project. Mm-hmm. He understands the connection between natural resources, a healthy city. You know, he's an advocate of all things in the neighborhood, and this is a vital project to Southbridge. So the administration under Mayor Williams' leadership allows the programming of the capital plan, right? And then City Council comes along, they're in support of it, and they approve it. So having said that, that's sort of the process. We've got about, so far, about $11 million in City of Wilmington capital budget, okay? Another $4 million from a very creative program called the Land Conservation Loan Program. That's a state of Delaware program, and it's very unique, and it's a $4.1 million loan that has no impact on the city's cash flow. It's a loan almost as if it's at 0% interest. So it sits on the city's books, but it doesn't have any additional impact in terms of the city's cash flow. And other funding sources include a $100,000 grant from the EPA, $20,000 grant from the Delaware chapter of the Nature Conservancy. And then that's the wetland. Now, Brian had mentioned the new infrastructure that goes underneath the town, the neighborhood of Southbridge. Mm-hmm. Brian, you want to address
that
funding source?
Yes, we have capital funds budgeted, I believe it's in the 2018 budget for the sewer separation project. So once, and we may be able to do that sooner, but once the wetlands project is constructed and the wetlands park is constructed, now we have a place to store that stormwater. While that's going on, we'll be doing the design on separating the stormwater out from the combined sewer so that as soon as possible, as soon as available, we can route that stormwater to the wetlands park. And one other thing to mention would be the brownfields money that's available in the project, the $1 million brownfields grant.
That's right.
For cleaning up. So we're very grateful to both the state for their support in the grant monies that they made available. And I think also one thing to note is that the city is one of the first municipalities in the entire state to implement a stormwater utility. And back in 2007, 2008, people might have noticed that their sewer bill slightly changed, and their sewer bill for sanitary sewer went down a little bit, and a new charge showed up on there for stormwater management. And so these funds are part of what enables us to budget this money for stormwater projects like this and to improve the quality of stormwater discharged out into the waterways. So it's actually our citywide ratepayers that are actually helping fund this through their stormwater utility bills.
To the benefit of all of us as Wilmingtonians,
yes.
Because of the impact that addressing all of this is ultimately going to have on the quality of life of people in Southbridge. So, you know, we start with Southbridge, and then there's a lot of deal making and science and technology and building, and then in the end there will be a palpable impact in the area of Southbridge because their quality of life will be different. Economic development will have a completely different chance because the area won't be affected again by the types of flooding that we're showing right now. I do know that another big piece of this project has been your community involvement. Alfred, could you talk about the workshop that you recently had where you invited community members to come in and learn about the project?
Absolutely. On September 23rd, we had a community workshop at Albert Palmer School in the Southbridge community. And that was a real opportunity for the project team. And the project team consists of the Economic Development Office, the Public Works Department, the Law Department, the Planning Department of the City of Wilmington. But we also have a lot of scientists and engineers that are helping us and supporting us to develop this project. And it was an opportunity for us to set up stations within the gymnasium of the school to explain every piece of this project, to explain the environmental piece and how we're cleaning up the contamination, the specific ways in which we're doing that, talking about the water and where the water is going to go and how that actually happens, talking about the park design and the plants that will be there and the walkways and the trails and such, and getting a little bit of community feedback on some of those pieces. So it was a wonderful event. Marie Reed, who is the president of the Southbridge Civic Association, was an amazing partner helping us pull this event off. We had over 80 people come out to attend. There were even stations for the children to work and play and learn a little bit about what was going on. And it was just a wonderful event for the city to come and engage the neighborhood and the broader City of Wilmington community about this massive infrastructure project and how it's going to change, really, the quality of life in that area of our city.
Absolutely. I've had the opportunity to talk to Ms. Reed, and the Civic Association there is very active and very passionate about what's going on in their part of town, as well as Councilwoman Hanifa Shabazz, who represents mm-hmm. that area. And listeners are encouraged to pick up a copy of Out and About for this month because we're writing about this. And it's a chance to kind of take your time and digest everything we've just shared with you. But both council and the community are on board with this. They really understand what's going on, and they're excited about it.
Absolutely.
And it makes me really proud to be able to tell everybody about this. These are the types of projects that you know things are going on, but to get the details really makes a big difference. Are there any other aspects of the project you'd like to share in our last few moments?
Well, you covered you covered a lot of it, though. I think overall, I mean, the exciting thing about this piece, and I think you've already talked about it, there are transportation elements of this, there are environmental elements, there are recreational elements, there are infrastructure elements to all of this. It's an amazing project that's been able to integrate so many disciplines. And for us to be able to bring this to the community and bring it to the City of Wilmington is just wonderful. Mm-hmm. To see this project that has been working and that has been developing for years and years and years finally come to a place where we can say this is it.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah.
One thing I'd like to add as Jeff started to go into, all those Phragmites that are on that website are a sign that are on that location are a sign that it's a dysfunctional wetland. It's an invasive species. It's a wet area, and it's one type of plant life that's just overtaken the whole area. And when it's done, it'll be a very diverse wetland park with all types of ecosystem, plants and plant life and animal life, mm-hmm. Be a very diverse ecosystem that'll be very healthy. We're excited to bring that to the residents of South Wilmington.
Yeah. I might add it's noteworthy that this project is going to have some key transportation linkages between the neighborhood of Southbridge and really that sort of eastern edge of that quadrant of the city and US 13 and the east bank of the riverfront. So There's going to be a boardwalk trail down the middle of the wetland that's going to connect sort of B Street over to the area right around where the Southbridge, or I'm sorry, the ShopRite shopping center is.
Oh, okay.
There's going to be B and C Streets, which sort of end in Southbridge at the edge of this wetland area, are going to be extended to a new Church Street. And then Church Street will run from A Street down to Garish's Lane. And then there'll be a new road bordering the southern part of the wetland that'll connect Church Street over to the area where the new Christina River Bridge is going to land. All of these areas are going to have bike paths, sidewalks. So it's going to be a chance to really connect two parts of the city that for years have sort of been disconnected by this large area.
Absolutely. And it's one of the reasons why in my opening I really wanted to connect